the numbers, but okay.
Don't have responsibility for this whatsoever.
I thought it'd say worse than that, to be fair, but okay.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ross. I'm the younger brother to James and best man for today. But before I get started, can I just ask you to please bear with me? Because to be honest, I will find this quite difficult today, talking in front of lots of people, being the quiet and shy member of the family. They say the best man speech is the most eagerly anticipated speech at a wedding. I'd like to lay down a few ground rules, if I may. So please, no heckling. Leave mobiles switched off. And a point on health and safety. I have spoken to the hotel manager, and he has asked me to ask you to refrain from standing on chairs and tables during my standing ovation. They also say it's a chance to embarrass the groom. But to be honest, James does a pretty good job of that himself. For instance, the stag do, the white water rafting experience. We're all waiting for our safety briefing, and James stumbles out of the dressing room, being the only person present to wear his wetsuit back to front. They also say that the best man speech is the worst 5 minutes of a groom's day at his wedding. Consequently, the bride's worst 5 minutes will come some later on tonight. In all honesty, James, I was a little unsure of what type of speech to do today. I was contemplating a brown envelope containing humorous and entertaining embarrassing stories, or maybe just a warm, heartfelt series of compliments on white paper. In all seriousness though, I have to say that James and Sarah today has been absolutely wonderful. A hats off to you, because the choices that you made with this wedding are unparalleled. Not just the venue, but colour schemes, I say guests, but some I won't mention. I'm getting too far. Sorry, I have to sit down. No, but I was quite surprised that James told me that he decided to do a slight but subtle Star Wars theme to the wedding. What with the cake and the names of the tables, obviously, in front of me. But I was a bit unsure about it, but then being here today, I have to say I'm pleasantly surprised, because how often do you really see Jabba the Hutt and Yoda at the table?
You will die.
Pay for that later, I will.
I'm pretty sure I speak for everyone, Sarah, when I say how beautiful you really do look today. And you clearly have a fan. In all seriousness, you do look stunning, and when Justin and I came to the final dress fitting, well, you saw how gobsmacked I was, because I think the taste is impeccable, and just words don't really do it justice, in fairness.
I will second that.
Yeah. So basically, in a nutshell, James is a lovely, funny, well-mannered, beautiful bride, and Sarah, well, you've got a nice ring. I'd also like to thank the bridesmaids, Amy and Fran. You've done a fantastic job today, assisting Sarah. And a special little thank you to Daisy, who walked down the aisle today sprinkling flowers. Can you have a round of applause for that, I think? We also, I'm sure I speak for James and Sarah in thanking all for coming today and helping them to eat and drink thousands of pounds of their hard-earned cash, condemning their first year of marriage to hardship, and in return, I'll buy fish and chips next week. Clearly, a special thanks goes out to people who have travelled far and wide to be here today. I believe we have some Glaswegians in the house. Yeah. And some people from Redditch. Yeah. And a couple of us from Turkey. What I have to say is, I'm amazed at what lengths a man will go to for a free meal. And James's now redundant dirty video collection. Now, as best man, another duty I have today is I have to fulfil some advice to the groom. Firstly, remember these four words, James. I assume they'll come in handy in the future scenarios. Yes, dear, you're right. Secondly, James, marriage is a 50-50 partnership. But if you believe that, then you clearly know nothing about women, or fractions. And thirdly, the best way to remember your anniversary is to forget one. But let's get serious for a moment. You guys are clearly perfect for each other. You can see that when you are together, the way you bounce off each other, the way you have good times, good laughs, and I can tell that you'll spend many happy years together. Marriage isn't about finding someone you can live with. It's about finding the person who you can't live without. So, I feel it's about time to do a toast. But we won't just stop there, will we? There's a brown envelope I have to bring out. I believe there's a poll on today how long this speech is going to last, so for the men who haven't shaved, you might need to. Right, well, before we get into the good stuff, it's important that you realise that the groom deserves a verbal hammering from his best man today. Over the years, he's put me through a fair bit, and I'm sure he's painted a wonderful picture of himself as a model big brother. Time when my parents went to the pub, shocking. And James and I would do the normal wrestling in the lounge, and James broke one of Mom's favourite ornaments. And he said to me, "Oh my God, Mom's gonna go nuts." And I was thinking, "Ah, it's not that bad, it'll be okay, it's fine, don't worry about it." So he agreed to pay me £5 to take the blame. Which at the time for a 9-year-old was tasty. So I said, "Yeah, great, okay, that's fine. I don't think it'd be a big deal." Obviously, Mom and Dad came home. They went nuts. After about half an hour of grilling, went up to James and said, "Right, give me £5." He went, "No." There was also a very brief moment when James hung me on the back of a bathroom door with a dressing gown rope, which we won't go into. That's right, he hung me.
That's nothing.
Also, I remember a time at Christmas when we agreed to buy our first Christmas presents for each other as brothers, and I made a good effort, wrapped it, put it under the tree. James also wrapped a something which was approximately this large and put it under the tree 2 weeks before Christmas. So I picked up the box, shaking it as an eager child at the time, not knowing what was inside, but I remember it being very, very light. And it was only on Christmas morning when I desperately unwrapped this present to find a Chew-It sellotape to a bottle of a shoebox. And of course, there was all the antagonizing noise that James used to make when he made fun of me or picked on me. It went something like this. "Hey, Ross. So I hope that gives you a good idea as to why he deserves the following. You have no idea how long I've waited for this. James, also known as Chunk to the masses, for, well, obvious reasons. Very large baby. Firstly, Mom, I don't know how you did it. Born on the 23rd of March, and you're probably wondering, who else was born on the 23rd of March? Well, you'd be surprised to hear that Mo Farah, Sir Chris Hoy, and Shaka Khan. All legends in their own right. However, thanks to my discretion, I have not publicised this to the media, therefore not jeopardising their successful careers. James was educated, well, I'll say that loosely, he attended Brightleys High School after sitting his GCSEs because the teachers, well, needed cheering up. He left school to learn to be an RSPCA animal fluffer. Here he learned how to clearly pull dogs based on previous partners, but then he met Sarah. Clearly punching above his weight. Hard to believe, I know. Now, I know it's deemed untasteful to mention the groom's exes, but James, what did happen with David? And Steve was so nice. I'm sorry to report that things did get worse later in life. He started dressing in women's clothing. For example, the Air Cadets fancy dress night. Not just any women's, but my mother's clothing. Further pictures can be found online at www.imgoingtokillmylittlebrother.com. James also does say some silly things from time to time. I always remember a Christmas party where we had a family game of Trivial Pursuit with some friends. And the particular question that came up next was, which sex is most likely to contract hepatitis C? And James went, oral? James has always been fond of a good night out. Drinking, dancing, the usual activities 21st century male revelers enjoy. But the dancing, I have to say, is quite unique. I first encountered, well, I mean, suffered this on holiday to the Dominican Republic. The aim set by the hotel animation team was the merengue, a nice, free-flowing Caribbean number. But what we got was quite interesting. The only way I can describe it is if you imagine RoboCop after smoking a joint in a straitjacket. Sarah, you might want to skip the first dance. Of course, the reason for the dancing was the drinking the night before. As the bar closed, James wandered around neighbouring tables at the hotel, drinking other guests' leftover cocktail drinks. Beautiful. In Germany, whilst watching the Formula One, James and I queued for the bar, waiting to be served. He had some urge to impress the locals with linguistic talents by trying to speak German. The following conversation went a little bit like this. Ross, what's two in German? Zwei. Oh, right, okay, great. And, what's beer? It's the same, it's just beer. And the waitress came to the bar and said, "Are you being served?" James went, "Two beers." I'd like to say stop there, but it clearly didn't. Later on that evening at the camp, our fire was burning low and we clearly needed more wood. So I noticed a nearby group of people had lots of wood, so I sent German James into battle. What those people got, well, you had to be there, but I'll try and recreate what I can. It was something along the lines of, "Ich bin wooden." The best of it is, they were French. Excuse me, I'm having some technical difficulties.